worship comes from Hebrews 4, 14 through 16, so please read along with me as we prepare our hearts to worship the Lord. In verse 14, it starts, it says, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then, with confidence, draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Let's pray. Lord, thank you that you are a great high priest. These words are true, that we can draw near to you with confidence this morning, not arrogantly, but humbly, thinking of what you did for us, and just the Savior that you are, that you came and you dwelt among us, you became flesh incarnate, so that we could know you and relate with you and know that you understand our weaknesses, Lord. You've experienced pain, you've experienced betrayal and heartache, and you just know us, and you know what it's like to be human. So we thank you for that, Lord, and would you draw near to us this morning as we draw near to you, God, in our songs, that we would tune our hearts to sing of your grace, Lord. Tune our hearts to sing your praise this morning, that we would bless you, and as we do, we'd experience that drawing and that nearness to your presence. We love you, and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. So would you join me and bless the Lord with us this morning?
To rescue me from danger, into your hands.
and our present help in times of trouble. Sing our hope, my hope.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I cannot trust the sweetest friend, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ's soul, it rose to heaven.
Will you pray with me? Lord, we come to you today with hearts of worship, for this is the day that you have made for us, and we thank you for this extravagant gift. Today we pray for the children around the world who are so dear to you. We know that they're missing a lot in this season: school, friends, sports, grandparents, proms, and even graduation. Their grief about these things matters to you. We pray for their fears and their worries that spill out when the lights go off. Let our presence be like yours, gentle and kind, comforting their hearts day after day. Oh, how we take great comfort in being called your children, and we desire to come to you with pure and sincere hearts like these little ones are teaching us. We pray for organizations around our city that regularly serve kids, like the East Atlanta Kids Club, who've had to change gears in the past 2 months from being an after-school program to a food delivery service for the families in our city. Please raise up these and other ministries as they serve diligently as your hands and feet around our city and around the world. We pray for the families that for sheltering in place isn't the best situation. Oh, how they must miss their school families and their teachers that give them hugs and care. Please be near them, O Lord. Your work of restoration started with a child. It began with the birth of a baby to a young marginalized girl. Your kingdom came to us then, and it comes to us now with children. May it be so. Amen.
Hi, City Church Eastside. This is Leslie Prince. I'm chair of the board of directors of Clifton Sanctuary Ministries, and I would like to say thank you so much for the opportunity to spend some time with you all in worship today. Things at Clifton have been quite busy over the last couple of months. The fellas who were in residence at the time of the COVID shutdown are still there. We're still serving them. We're not taking any new referrals right now, but we are serving them, and we are so thankful to be able to share the news that the guests and our staff were all tested by the Fulton County Department of Public Health and Mercy Care last week, and everyone is negative. So we are giving thanks to God for that. You're probably seeing some pictures of a little barbecue we had this past weekend to celebrate that good news, because they have really been committed to this and have formed a team, and they're a family, and they're taking care of each other. And so we're just so excited about that. We also want to say thank you for your input and your impact on Clifton, the meals that you bring, the love that you share with the fellas. During our normal operation, when you come in and serve meals, is just fabulous, and we could not do it without you. Clifton celebrated our 40th anniversary back last November, so we're in our 41st year of providing love and hospitality to men who are homeless throughout the city of Atlanta. Thousands and thousands of men have come through our doors, and it certainly would not be possible if it were not for our great volunteers and friends and churches like City Church Eastside that continue to walk with us and walk with the guys as they work diligently to transform their lives. So again, please let us say thank you. Please feel free to, once we return to normal operation, to stop by and say hello. God is busy, busy, busy over at Clifton. Lives are being transformed, both our guests' lives, our volunteers' lives, and our staff lives. And we are so grateful for that. So thank you again. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Hey, City Church Eastside. I'm Alicia DiCriscio, wife of Dan DiCriscio, executive pastor. We also lead the Southside Community Group together. Since the lockdown, we've had the opportunity to coordinate the purchase of groceries for families in need on the south and west sides of Atlanta. Each week, I receive a list from social workers at our elementary school of families in need, and I actually share it with a friend who's a missionary in Germany, and she shares it with her global network. That means a family in Germany could be buying groceries for a family in Atlanta through Instacart or Amazon. The week of spring break, we opened it up to City Church, and I'd like to thank the Caspers, the Orms, and the Smith Venezes for each purchasing groceries for a week for one family. It's grown from 3 families a week to now we have 13 families who are in need this week. If you'd like to help, please email me at adecriscio@gmail.com. It's a great opportunity to serve and be the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you.
Today's sermon text reading comes from John 1, 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave right to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So many years ago, I was at a speaking engagement in Buffalo, New York, and the man that picked me up from the airport, his name is Bruce. We're going to call him Bruce 1 because there are two Bruces in the story. Bruce was a concert promoter for Western New York, and he had U2 playing in his car when I got in. I said, hey, really like your taste of music, and picked up on that. He's like, oh. And so he reaches down underneath his seat. He's got a cassette tape of the first concert that U2 did in America. It was a bootleg that he had, and he's like, hey, man, you can have it. Now, this is 2000, and even by 2000, people were not using cassette tapes, and I couldn't even use it. But I was grateful that he gave it to me. Then he also gave me a concert pin from U2. It was really cool as well. And he could see just I was coming alive as he was sharing this U2 paraphernalia with me. And so he said, hey, I've got to introduce you to a guy named Bruce. This is Bruce 2 in the story. Bruce 2 was the original gangster, the OG, that brought U2 to America, that made them in America what they are known today. He was the one who introduced U2 to the record execs. They eventually signed with a label called Island Records. And it was this guy, this Bruce, that did it. So we go down to Bruce's office in downtown Buffalo. And on the wall of their office, everything else has been painted around this, but where the signatures that were scrawled on the wall of Bono and his bandmates. They had been there for a concert early in the 80s and had marked the wall with their names. And so I'm just taking it all in. I'm so excited. Huge aficionado of all things U2. And seeing that, Bruce 1 says to Bruce 2, hey man, why don't you play that song from your surprise 50th birthday party where Bono sang to you? I was like, oh my gosh. And so he pulls out, while the song is about to be played, or about it's starting to be played, this photo album. And it's Bruce 2 with Bono, his wife Allie, Bono's wife, and the kids. And they're at a cookout at the pool at their estate in Ireland. And Bruce 2 is just putting his arm around the family, just hanging out like it's no big deal. I'm just taking it all in. And then the song plays, and you know, it's Bono singing like a drunken Irishman. Happy birthday. And at the very end of the song, he says, happy birthday, Bruce. It's my best Irish brogue, sorry. But I mean, here's this guy, me, who really wants to get to know someone like Bono, the ultimate celebrity for me. And here's someone who actually knows him, and yet, Bruce, too, as well as he knows Bono, it pales in comparison to what Bono's wife knows about Bono. And there's just degrees of satisfaction here. And kids, I know you're watching right now. I mean, there's probably someone in your life. It's a singer. It's another celebrity. There's someone, man, if I could just beat them, how satisfying would that be? And what this passage is about ultimate satisfaction, because it's the ultimate picture of God's revelation, that we're made to know someone, namely God. And here we are in the midst of a pandemic, where we are face-to-face with the problems that existed before the pandemic, but some of those have been really, really surfaced now. As I said last week, these toxins in our soul. And the answer to all of our problems, pre-pandemic, now, post-pandemic, will always be the same. It is knowing God through Jesus Christ. And so we turn our attention to this remarkable statement here. It begins, in the beginning. Sound familiar? It's new creation. John says that God's mission is to do creation all over again. To recreate its new creation, new birth. And so to that end, here's what I want us to see. I want us to see God's message to us through the word and then our response. It's really a two-part of each thing. God's first message, our response, the second message from God, and our second response. So jumping in here, looking at verses 1 through 3 as part of God's first message here. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. We could probably do a whole series just on these three verses, much less the first 14 verses of the book of John. And the word here for beginning is arche. Think architect. This is someone who's creating, but this is the source of creation, the beginning point. The ultimate beginning point. I read an article this past week from cosmologists and physicists asking this question regarding the beginning of everything. And so they're referring to the Big Bang, and so they asked this question, what happened before the Big Bang? Their belief of how the world got going, basically. You know what they all said to a person in the article? They said that maybe matter, there was something that was there before the Big Bang, this little piece of matter, infinitely dense, and it exploded. In other words, and actually they use this language, that there's something eternal or infinite about matter. And I thought to myself, wow, talk about smuggling metaphysics in. In other words, beliefs that aren't necessarily part of physics, part of physicality, but smuggling in these other beliefs, even though their world and life view by and large doesn't support something like that, they can't help but go there. What is the beginning of the beginning? What is the source of it all? And what John says is that there was no beginning with the Word. That when we began in time, there was someone who was prior to that. And John says in the word, in the original Greek, logos. And the idea for the ancient Greeks was that this was a design principle, bringing order out of chaos. It's like this. Right now, we are ordering furniture from IKEA. And of course, it's do-it-yourself, and get this piece of furniture that's named after something in Sweden, Tor Elofsson. You're like, okay, that's my desk now, Tor Elofsson. And so you get the instructions, and you hope that these Swedes have properly translated the design principle into English, right? You hope that sometimes it works out well, sometimes not. And what John is saying is that this is the perfect design principle, but then he says this, it's not a principle. That's where the ancients got it wrong. It's a person. And that's why he says, he was present there. Him. He was the Word. It's personal. In other words, it's not enough to say that the universe has a design to it, but there's a designer. There's one who has done this, and he chooses to disclose himself. You see, in any relationship, the way that you know someone is you disclose yourself to them. Kirsten and I dated long distance more than 20 years ago before we got married 20 years ago. And as a result of that, we spent countless hours on the phone together. And we had these long strings of emails. I mean, literally, you could write a book with all of our emails. There were so many hundreds of pages that Kirsten kept and then printed out. And in each phone call and with each email, what were we doing? We were disclosing more and more about ourselves to each other. And I'm here to say that after 20 years of marriage, we are still learning new things about ourselves. What's the point, Scott? The ultimate disclosure of God was to come in flesh and have a message. He himself was the message. He himself was the word. He himself was the disclosure, he says. Which brings us to verse 14. This is a great picture of intimacy, looking at just now at the front part, the first part of verse 14. He says this: "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." The Word became flesh. Eugene Peterson, in his transliteration, says the Word moved into the neighborhood. He moved in. He got close. And think about where we were the first 2 weeks of this series called The Glory of God. We were in the book of Exodus, and you might be asking, why were we there? Well, here's why. I wanted you to see a picture of pre-incarnate Jesus, the burning bush, the angel of the Lord. And as you move out of Exodus, you see that the Lord tabernacling, it says. It's the same translation sometimes in verse 14. He moved in, he tabernacled among us. And so the tabernacle became the temple. And you see this movement each time of God's presence becoming more and more personal. What John says in chapter 1, at the beginning of new creation, God reveals the fullness of his closeness to us. And why is that so important? Because right now, in the midst of a pandemic, we are dying for closeness, aren't we? We are longing to have that more and more. You know, I've spent countless hours, speaking of countless hours, on Zoom technology. And right now, you're watching this. But it can never be as good as actually being present in a worship service. Right now, the things that we took for granted, being able to come to worship, being able to give a hug, all that stuff is gone for the time being right now. We're in the midst of a great lament about that. And Zoom technology, as good as it is, it can never be as good as face-to-face, you see. And what John is saying is that we have the best thing, that we're made for this, but, and this leads to the second point, our response has been not to want that closeness. Look at verses 5, then also 10 and 11. Verse 5, it says this: "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." And then verses 10 and 11: "He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him." Why didn't they receive him? We're told in verse 5. It says, because they embraced darkness. But it's fascinating here, this phrase, "darkness has not overcome it" here. There's a commentator named D.A. Carson, and I like what he said here about that verse. He said, "This is a masterpiece of planned ambiguity." Here's what he meant by that. The word "overcome" can have two meanings. And the first one can be more outright hostility. And so that might be someone who maybe they identify themselves as an atheist, or maybe you've been on a social media feed and you see that comment dripping with condescension about your belief by faith. You know, they say, well, that's just belief in a fairy tale. A God who doesn't exist. And you see that contempt, that outward hostility, or maybe you think of a country like China, whose government is literally bulldozing churches as we speak, persecuting Christians left and right. That's outward hostility. But the majority of people don't have an approach to Jesus like that. It's much more of the second meaning of "overcome" here, and that's not to understand. It's to embrace certain things about Jesus, but not the whole picture of Jesus, you see. And so it's to embrace him as a prophet, as a teacher, I think for a lot of us, we really need to hear this. You can be deeply religious this morning. You can be a great fan of Jesus, a great fanboy, fangirl, right? But you can also keep Jesus at a distance because he's not Lord of your life. And so when it says the darkness has not overcome it, part of that is saying that this understanding or this lack of understanding, this is what that Jesus came for, to wrestle with. He didn't just come for those who were certainly prodigal sons and daughters that were outwardly that way, right? The thief on the cross, for instance. The prostitutes. But he came for the religious people, and they have the most difficult time of all, it would seem, of coming to know him. In other words, it's not about the depth of your morality. You can be the poster child for civics lessons 101 for your neighborhood. You can be, because of your religiosity, deeply given over to good works and so forth, right? But Jesus came for those who were outwardly hostile and those who were inwardly hostile, who rejected him by calling him something other than Lord, perhaps even some of us watching this right now. And I want you to see the second part of our response here. It's what happens when the light comes on. Verse 4, he says that this is the light and the life of the world. The light has come into the world. And what happens when you turn a light on? This past week, we found that out when a certain type of bug with wings scattered when the light came on, and one of my daughters, she screamed like a banshee as a result of that. And that's what happens. Like, what happens is that the darkness flees. The darkness can't overcome it. So when the light comes on, by definition, the darkness flees. And when Jesus came, when the lights came on, what was exposed were shame. There are ways that we do that. You know, one of the things that we were saying in this series is that the brilliance of God is his glory, but the nature of humanity in our darkness is to steal that glory. It's like this. You can have a superiority complex, and when you meet someone who might have that superiority complex, we say, well, they seem to be really high on the hog about themselves. But the truth is this. Someone who has a superiority complex actually is deeply insecure. And the reason why they're deeply insecure, the reason why it's the accolades in the office, it's the academics, it's the athletic performance, and they begin to say, oh, I'm pretty good, aren't I? Maybe you yourselves hear that and say, man, that's me sometimes. The reason why we are like that is because we have a dearth of a depth of glory. We're out of sync with the glory that we're made for, the gravitas that we're made for with God, and so we steal that glory out of our insecurity. That's the basis for a superiority complex. And what he says here is, I think is what he's saying, is that the reason why we become that way is because we want to cover our shame. People won't enjoy us. People won't accept us if they know everything truly about us. And so if this is where the story ended, it would end with darkness. It would end with God and his holiness and his judgment ending us, but that's not where the story ends. Because of God's second response here. It's in verse 14, but we'll read the whole thing this time. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. You may have wondered, again, why did we start the series in Exodus? Well, this is, at least in the Old Testament, this is where we get to see God's glory on display in some mighty and powerful ways. We looked at chapters 3 and 14, but after that, Moses, because he's getting to know God better, he wants more and more of God. The more he learns about God, the more he wants. And so he says in chapter 34, I want to see you face to face. And this is how God responds to him, verses 5 through 7. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, Lord, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. What's he saying? It's this. It's the idea of steadfast love. The word there in Hebrew is hesed. covenant love, God's response to this yearning to be known is to manifest his glory, to put it on display in the fullness of it. Did you see that here? Grace and mercy. Grace and mercy. It's not just the truth of God, but the grace and mercy of God. It's like this, right? If you have a boss, most of us do. If you have a boss, that boss, they have a certain standard of behavior, a certain decorum of how you carry out your job, a certain code of conduct. And it doesn't matter how competent you are, if you were to misbehave and continue to misbehave and to act in an unprofessional manner, at some point, that boss is going to cut the cord with you. You're going to lose your job. But the difference between a boss and a good father could not be more different. You could misbehave ad infinitum. But when a father's really good, and this is something I struggle with, I so easily with my children go to anger, right? But when I'm a good father, when I experience that, I'll go to compassion. Now, there's truth with the grace, right? I'm full of grace and truth. We're told that right here. But that truth is dripping with grace. And so the father says, when my prodigal goes off and away, I want to run after them. I want to be face to face with them again. The Lord, full of grace and truth, steadfast love, forgiving the sin and iniquity, which begs this question: how did he do it? And the answer is, it's right here in the passage. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he moved into the neighborhood. It's Jesus. It's the incarnation. It's the Word becoming flesh. It's his birth and then his life. And at the end of his life, after his life of goodness, talk about the character of God being on display, the glory of God, as we sang, it's really about seeing and revealing the character of God for the nations. Jesus did that perfectly. And the one who was the Word, the one who was the revealed speech of God, if you want to know who God is, you get to know Jesus. What does he do? He stands before Pilate. At the moment when he could have gotten off the hook, when he could have gotten off the cross, and Pilate says, one word, Jesus, one word, and you're set free. That one word would be innocence. What does Jesus do? The Word made flesh, the message of God, silent. Isaiah tells us, silent before his accusers. All Jesus, the Word, had to do was speak in a manner that would allow him to get off the cross, and yet if he did that, paradoxically, he wouldn't be the Word of God. He wouldn't be the message of salvation, Lord of Savior and sinners, the one who forgives for 1,000 generations the sin and iniquity of us all. No wonder Paul celebrates in a wonderful hymn in Philippians 2. He celebrates God in that humility, the glory of God being on display in his humility. He says this in verses 6 through 8. He says, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death. Glory of God, the greatness and goodness of God, humility. And right after this, beginning verse 9, that's when he says, and now he's been exalted. He sits at the right hand of God the Father in his resurrection, in his ascension. The fullness now of his glory there, and yet it's here in his death and then the resurrection that we see. How much does God love us? How much does he want to disclose himself to us? He said, steadfast love. And so the last thing that it leads to naturally here is, how do we want to respond to that? Because if our first response has been darkness, how do we have the opportunity now to respond? It's two things. Number one is to receive him. Look at verses 12 and 13 with me again. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of Here's the thing. If you want to go to a party, you have to receive the invite and then actually go. 18 years ago, we moved to Orlando to start seminary together as husband and wife. And we moved to this neighborhood across the street from the seminary. And we decided, hey, the way that we're going to get to know people in the neighborhood, we need to throw a party in our house. And so we went up and down the blocks, inviting anyone and everyone to come to a party. And we went to this one home, and this woman, a single woman, opened the door, and she said, in 12 years of living here, I've never been invited to a party. 12 years. Well, we were overjoyed to hear that. We're like, hey, time's now. This is going to be awesome. Great. And oh my gosh, you know, we invited everyone, and then that party came. You know, came two children of our next door neighbor. The mother didn't even come in that household. And then the woman, 12 years, no invite, no show. See, it's not enough to receive the invite to the party. You got to go. And why wouldn't you want to go to the party where the honored guest is a celebrity? But this is not, but Jesus is not just a celebrity. In fact, he's the opposite of celebrity. See, the word celebration, celebrity, come from the same root, don't they? And Jesus is the opposite. Why? Because if I really got to know Bono, if I really got to know him, I would be disappointed. At some point, this ideal of what I think and who Bono is, I would be let down. He would disappoint me. But what happens with Jesus is the opposite. The more you get to know him, the less disappointed you are, the more you actually get to see the fullness of his perfection. And again, that glory, that character on display, the more you say, I want to know you more and more and more. That's what it means to be a disciple. And as a result of that, it leads to the second thing here. If you've received the invite to call him Lord of your life, then secondly, you walk with him. In Matthew chapter 5, Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, you are the light of the world. It's fascinating because elsewhere, verse 4, he says, in the beginning, he was the light and the life of all things, right? And then elsewhere, he says, I am the light of the world, elsewhere in the book of John, in fact. And in Matthew 5, he says, you're the light of the world. What's he saying? He says, because you're made in my image, because you're my disciple, now I send you out to be the hands and feet of me to the world, you see. And Paul picks up on that in Ephesians 5. He says, live as children the light. How does that happen on the other side of the death and the resurrection of Jesus? Remember, in the Old Testament, the Father, where do we see the Father? God in the temple, that's his presence. Then in Jesus, we see the one who tabernacled, verse 14 in translation, he tabernacled among us. Another word for the temple there. He is the temple, right? But Paul picks this up in 1 Corinthians 3:16. Listen to what he says. Do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Father, Son, Spirit, temple. You are God's temple. The hands and feet of Jesus. John Tillman, a writer, says this, Christ's human realness makes the gospel tangible. His defeat of death was not symbolic, but actual. Jesus did real things in the real world and calls us to be real human beings who act to benefit our world in real, tangible ways. Just as Jesus came to us humbly, we are commanded to humbly go to others. Just as Jesus was able to live among us, we are sent to live among people. Jesus shared in our humanity in order to reach us. So we should share in the humanity of those around us as we walk and serve as his hands and feet on earth. How does this passage end? This passage ends with a call to continue the incarnation. Jesus says, I go and sit at the right hand of God the Father, but I send you the counselor, the Holy Spirit. Do you not yet know that you are God's temple? Paul says. Don't you see? The church, you and I, even though we're scattered right now in the midst of this pandemic, you and I get a chance to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And right now, this is true before the pandemic, it will be true afterwards as well. Desperately need to see what is the story of hope. What is the story of hope? The living word, the living hope. The hands and feet of Jesus. May we be the church that demonstrates the truth of the incarnation, grace and truth, tabernacling among us everyone who took on flesh. And in taking on flesh, you took on our story, our heart of darkness, our brokenness. You took on the hostility. You took on the oppression that we laid upon you. And the burden of our hostility, the burden of our iniquity, laid you in the grave, but the grave could not hold you. For you are glorious, exalted. Side of the rolled away stone, the empty tomb. May we be the church proclaiming the greatness, the goodness, that you are our King, that you are before the beginning. You are our beginning. You are our new creation. And you will be the final word in our lives. And we will have that final word on our lips for all of eternity, a world without end, new creation life. Lord Jesus, may we live to that now. May we transport what will be true in full and perfection in the future. May we transport that into our here and now, hands and feet, flesh and blood, in our world today, in our city of Atlanta that we so deeply love. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Now we turn our attention to confession. It's our opportunity to speak back to God what we've heard today in His Word. He's the living Word. We're intended to marinate ourselves in Him and to respond to the living Word. So let's use this confession as we always do. There'll be a moment of private confession at the end of this public one. Father, forgive us for how we have turned our backs upon your Son, Jesus, who is grace and truth in the flesh. We have sought self-glory, stealing yours, when we were made to find our significance and worth in your glory. You have offered us deep, intimate relationship with yourself, but we have chosen to go our own way. Thank you for dying for your oppressors, including ourselves, and teach us to embrace the living Word, Jesus, that our lives might bring you glory. Amen. And now, pray silently. And now, hear the assurance of pardon. As far as east is from west, the psalm says, I have separated your transgressions from you. As far as the east is from the west. Think about that. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ and this has been your own personal confession, you've been set free. The gospel is not simply something that saves you. It's how you live your life. And he reminds you that you have been set free through confession. We say to that, normally at this point, if we were all here together, it would be our opportunity to now take communion together. And a number of you have been asking over the last several weeks, what about communion? And so I just wanted to say a quick word about that. Why is it that we're not able to take communion together? First, communion is a family meal. And right now the family's not together. Yes, in spirit we are, but communion itself is actually a sacrament of the church, what's called ordinance. It's an opportunity for us to practice the faith together in a community, communion. And because we're scattered, we can't do that yet. But the reason why I mention that is this. I know that we are longing, myself included, longing not just to be face-to-face with each other, but to actually take the bread, to take the wine. We're made for that. We're longing for that. So what do you do now? Just like the psalmist does in Psalm 40, how long, O Lord? In Psalm 42, as a deer pants, so I thirst for you. Allow this time of wilderness journey to be an opportunity to say, how long, O Lord, but how I thirst and how I hunger to take the table with your people again. Use this as an opportunity for worship that it might draw your heart to his. We believe that sooner rather than later, we're going to be back together again. More information on that in the next couple weeks. And so how beautiful will it be to take the table again? I just wanted to mention that now as an opportunity for us to answer question that we have. And now hear God's benediction for you for this week. Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. Say this. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may it work in this way, pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, who may glory forever and ever.